It's a pleasure and honor for me to be here in the company of the Dirac Medallist of the year 2021. The 2021 Dirac Medal was awarded to four Dirac Medallists for establishing the predictive properties of gravitational waves in the curvature of spacetime produced when stars or black holes spiral together and merge. And this work was essential for this very important discovery, detection of gravitational waves from the merger of two black holes and the analysis discovered in the LIGO and the analysis of the LIGO-Virgo data. And I'm very happy. Unfortunately, one of the Dirac medalists is not here, could not be here in person. So we have here Thibault, Damour, Alessandra Buonanno, and Frans Pretorius, and Saul Teukolsky could not be here, but we will hear about his work from the other three. And so maybe let me begin with asking Thibault, you are sort of the senior statesman of this field. So I think this idea of inspiraling black holes and calculating how they behave, I think goes back to, I mean, the initial calculations go back to Einstein and the post-Newtonian approximation, but then to really bring it to the level of LIGO sensitivity, you had to really go to, you know, develop many techniques to go bring it to the level of sensitivity that was required. So maybe you can start by commenting on the sort of the state of the field in which you found it and how you developed it and where you took it.
Yes, so my interest in radiation reaction effects of gravitational wave emission and their back action on the motion of binary systems dated back to when I was a young postdoc and I arrived in Princeton in September 1974 and people announced the discovery of the first binary pulsar by Joe Taylor and Russell Hertz. And very quickly it was understood that this was a system where the emission of gravitational wave by the two neutron stars going around, so already compact objects, not black holes, and quite far from each other. So there was a small effect of radiation reaction, but it was large enough to be measured by the very high accuracy of the timing of the pulsar. And at the time, there was a controversy between some theorists who said there are no good ways of computing this. So I took this as a challenge to get a better derivation already at the lowest order where radiation reaction is important. And already, so it took a few years of work actually, because the discovery was 74 and we got the final answer in 1982, which at the lowest order confirmed heuristic reasonings, but got a better proof of an effect that was observable. And I reported on this result at a summer school in France, in Les Ouches. And at this summer school, the progress and the vision that one should detect within a finite number of years gravitational waves using interferometers were presented, like Ron Hellings presented the idea of power recycling. And Kip Thorne in that school presented what at the time he had worked out on the theory of emission of gravitational waves. And then I understood that although some of the tools were quite good and had promise of doing something, there was a lot of things to do. So I took it as a second challenge to work on an improved way of computing the motion of binary systems of two neutron stars or black holes and the back action of gravitational waves. And it took now 20 years later, so it took developments, including a lot of work with somebody who is now visiting ICTP for a different workshop with Luc Blanchet, who is around also, my PhD student at the time. And then around in 1998, after having brought some tools, there was the big problem, which was pointed out in America by Kip Thorne, saying probably there is no way to use analytical methods, pencil and paper methods, to go to the last orbits, because at the end they go fast, so forget about things you can do with really equations. But we were bold enough to think, no, we can improve what exists and push the accuracy of all the previous work, which was developed over 20 years, to be able to predict already in 2000 what was the signal from the merger of two black holes. And then it took five more years before Frans actually was able to do numerical simulations. And I will leave the rest of the story to Alessandra Frans.
No, so that's interesting. So your initial motivation was clearly for pulsars.
Yes.
The in-spiral is good enough. I mean, you're
exactly.
not really trying to...
Exactly. There was a level of accuracy where the theory was enough. Then a new experiment comes on the horizon, and then you say, okay, so I have to push the theory beyond, which means a program and which means years of work of many people. So indeed, but in all this, indeed, I was motivated by the fact that this was something observable,
you know,
because I was never interested in doing calculations for calculations, for the pleasure of calculations, which is sometimes good, sometimes meager, but really the aim of connecting with the real world.
Right. And I think pulsar was, I mean, the accuracy there was really high.
Yes.
And there was clearly, you know, indication of
it was the first proof and that the gravitational
proof.
Radiation, not indirect. I had a long discussions with Ray Weiss on this, which apparently are reflected in the book of Harry Collins. No, that it's quite direct, because in a binary pulsar you see directly that the two things get together. And this is an effect of the fact that gravitational radiation propagated from one pulsar to the next at the velocity of light. So it's a direct proof that gravity propagates at the velocity of light.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it's indirect in the sense that you don't directly
it's
measure the gravitational
that you don't, waves. Exactly. Yeah. So it's semi-indirect, yes.
I think, and the next step was, I think, what you did with this effective one-body approach, which you developed together with both of you. What you said, at IHS,
when Alessandra was started. Postdoc working with me.
At IHS. So, yeah, maybe you can comment on that part of the history where it...
Yeah, so actually, I finished my PhD in 1996, and I was working in theoretical cosmology at the time. And then I was offered a postdoctoral position at IHS, so I moved there in 1997 in September. I was actually quite inspired by a workshop that took place close to IHS in Orsay, one of the first workshops in gravitational wave data analysis, where in particular I was inspired by a session where people were discussing how to search for gravitational waves with the data of the 40-meter interferometer which had been built at Caltech at the time. So I met also at this conference several people, including Kip Thorne, Satya Prakash, Eric Poisson, etc., people that then I encountered many years later. And in any case, in the first months, we work on something else with Thibault, but then we...
Some of them involving radiation reaction.
Radiation
in
reaction in cosmic strings, actually.
Cosmic strings.
Yeah. And also with Gabriele Veneziano, who was on sabbatical at the time at IHS, so we continue to work on cosmology. But then in the summer, so I got interested in the two-binary problem, and
because when the speed roughly becomes like one-third of the speed of light, right? Then
the approximation.
The approximation
so
let's say
it becomes more and more inaccurate.
Yeah, and so you have to think of new ways.
Yes, and also at the time, the post-Newtonian calculation were not available at very high order. Mm-hmm. So, and it was not clear whether the series was convergent, or asymptotic, etc. And also it became clear also to me that if black holes with masses 30, 20 solar mass existed in binary system, they would merge in the sweet spot of the detector. So if one didn't have an accurate waveform for the late part of the in spiral and the merger in down, we could miss the signal. And so we work out mainly motivated by, I think, the idea that perhaps one could simplify the problem through a mapping with a one-body description, the formation of a black hole, could be Schwarzschild or Kerr. Maybe the two-body description could be simplified through it. So we come up with the first paper with a mapping of the Hamiltonian and the binding energy. And then I moved to Caltech as a Stallman Fellow in 1999. And there I completed with Thibault the second paper, which had the prediction for the dynamics, including the last part of the in-spiral, then the merger. And what was interesting is that just using some physical intuition, the tools available at the time, what was known about how to describe the perturbations of the final black hole work that goes back to Vishveshvara and Press, and also Teukolsky, Reggie Wheeler, etc., Zerilli. So we had also a way of predicting or estimating the final mass and final spin for which that you need to know in order to determine the frequency of the quasi-normal modes, at least the dominant one, so that we could actually obtain the full signal, so the late in spiral, the plunge, the merger, and the ring down. Of course, at the time, was a semi-analytical, you know, result, was an estimate.
And nobody believed in it. Yes.
And I have to say, yes, well,
we were only it the was, two of us believing that this had value.
So when I was at Caltech as a fellow, I entered the LIGO scientific collaboration through the Memorandum of Understanding of Kip Thorne. So I was also immediately exposed to, you know, all the complications of trying to use waveforms for analysis, learn a lot also when I was there on these topics. And people would trust the in-spiral part of the signal, but perhaps less this, you know, bold estimate about how one could complete the waveform for the merger in down. Until actually,
For good reason, France. I think this is how science progresses.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
They were right to be critical and say, wait until something else confirms that this is a valid estimate.
Right.
Because in fact, the main, perhaps the assumption was that the merger would have been very simple, that you wouldn't see any high frequency features and would be just a very natural continuation of the in spiral, you know, until you go then to the ring down. So this was also a quite bold, perhaps, assumption at the time.
And then actually, one thing too, it wasn't even clear that cosmic censorship would be respected by mergers in general. So there was evidence that head-on collisions were, and people could look at close limits. So there wasn't cosmic censorship violation once you had a single black hole that was ringing down. There wasn't while they were spiraling in. But I mean, this is a very
violent process, just for the audience, by cosmic censorship, you mean the fact that there could be a naked singularity.
Right, because as soon as there's a naked singularity, then you've lost all predictive power with classical gravity. Then you would need a quantum theory of gravity to be able to evolve forwards. So that would have been disastrous for our ability to actually use LIGO if a naked singularity appeared.
I mean, it could have been very exciting for quantum gravity.
Yeah,
it would have been very exciting, but it would have been disastrous.
Sad, it does not have
predictability. Yes.
But for example, a prediction that we had, you know, analytically, was also that the angular momentum at the end of the plunge, if you were using it to estimate the spin of the object, would be actually less than one. So it, you know, it was possible basically at that point to form a black hole. You didn't need to emit more angular momentum, you know. So that was also a nice, I would say, prediction that that we had, that the model
you know. When the two things that they lose enough energy and angular momentum to be compatible with forming immediately a black hole.
And not spiral out again, you know, in order to lose more angular momentum. Uh-huh. And actually we even got these results, including spins for the black holes at the time in the work with Yanbei Chen.
I see. That's very interesting. So maybe then I can, because you come from a, so this is actually very interesting. I will come to that question later, that very different communities, so to speak. You come from the numerical relativity community, very independently of what the analytical work that was being done. And okay, Saul is not with us, but maybe he's one of the pioneers of numerical relativity, going back many years. And so maybe you can start, how you've found the numerical relativity community.
Why were you interested in numerical relativity? Why did you feel it was an important problem for a postdoc?
For a graduate student.
For a graduate student, when did you start?
Yes, well, I entered in for my PhD with Matt Choptwick in numerical relativity.
I see.
Before that, I did a master's degree with Werner Israel. Actually, my background's in computer engineering. And so I sort of felt I had to do a bit of catch-up before going to the full PhD, so I did the master's first. And when I was finished with my master's, there were two areas that I was very interested in, string theory, because at the time it was sort of the second string revolution. They discovered how to count black hole microstates.
Yes.
And then there was gravitational waves. And all the things related to black holes and relativity fascinated me. So one was sort of the string side, one was the gravitational wave side. And I guess because I love computers, you know, sort of the natural approach that I would have taken on that side would have been numerical relativity. Mm-hmm. And then so I applied to grad school for PhD in several places. I perhaps won't mention the string theorist that turned me down. And so it was the Matt Choptwick accepted me, the string theorist turned me down. At that time, it would have been a coin flip for me.
Yes.
And so this was just very fortuitous in hindsight.
It perhaps fitted very well with your, to bring in this expertise from computer computation to numerical relativity was.
The funny thing is, at the time, I was sort of in a bit of despair that how many years have I wasted on this computer science degree, in hindsight, it really worked very well together.
Yeah, but maybe I should ask you that. As I understand, so I don't work in this field, but that, in a way, your numerical methods, first of all, the numerical methods already existed, but there was you sort of broke the logjam in a way and had some breakthrough. Right. So can you describe what was the breakthrough? What was the key idea that sort of broke the logjam?
Right. So I'd say there were a couple, though at the time, as you mentioned, the entire community was working very hard, probably starting in the early 90s, on the binary problem. Both the pencil and paper analytic work that Alessandra and Thibault eventually sort of got the gold standard with the effective one-body approach. But the numerical relativity community was also working very hard. And there were many ideas, many approaches. But when I entered grad school and postdoc, and actually I took over Alessandra's position as a Tolman Fellow at Caltech in 2002. The problem was that all the codes were crashing.
Very fast, no? Black holes could just move a little bit and the code crashed.
Yeah. So they'd set them in orbit, they'd go for a bit, they'd crash. The problem with these codes and the Einstein equations, the nonlinearity, is everything has to work together. So it's very difficult to figure out exactly if there's only one thing that's
what
wrong, how do you find it? And so, for example, there were many cases where people said, okay, this is too complicated. Let's start with a single black hole. They'd perturb it, it would go, and it would crash. So
even a single black hole was crashing.
Then they'd figure out what was wrong with the single black hole. They'd take it to the binary. It wouldn't work.
There was this SXS collaboration. So who is
the simulating extreme space times collaboration?
Yeah, so that was one of the the earliest big collaboration was this NSF Grand Challenge. I think that ended around 1998. I don't exactly know when the SXX collaboration, that's what Saul Teukolsky was involved with.
So that was what he was leading.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I think that started actually in, I was at Caltech during that time with Kip Thorne, I think. They established it, so we are talking about early 2000s.
Yeah, so that started in the early 2000s. So at the time when I sort of was building my code, there was a whole laundry list of things that I thought had to be done correctly for it to work. But perhaps just to keep this conversation simple, so there were actually two things that I think that were key in the end that came up with a successful one. One is the so-called formulation of the Einstein equations. You can write the Einstein equations in many different ways. And the formulation that I used was a harmonic formulation. And that's actually very interesting that was the formulation where Yvonne Chouquet-Brouhaha in 1952 proved the first local well-posedness theorem for the Einstein equations. So it seemed to be a very nice and natural coordinate system to use. On the other hand, because it essentially imposed that the coordinates satisfy wave equations, there was a sort of a fear that if you try to use it in a numerical simulation, now in a dynamical situation, which is very, very dynamical, and the coordinates are acting like waves, these waves are going to superimpose. Mm-hmm. And for example, if the time wave superposes, the amplitude becomes too large, time will run off too fast, and the slice will become, you'll get a coordinate singularity. Mm-hmm.
This harmonic thing was by Garfinkel and
that was sort of the next step. So the numerical relativity community avoided harmonic coordinates because of this fear, despite mm-hmm. the fact that it wasn't actually shown that that was a problem. But then David Garfinkel at least proposed an in-principle solution, the so-called generalized harmonic coordinates. So you can say, the coordinates satisfy these wave equations, but we can add little forcing functions. We can force the wave to damp itself mm-hmm. in principle. So he was actually interested in simulations approaching a singularity. So he wanted to know what's going on inside black holes. So he actually didn't propose any source function. He just noted that there was a solution. I was actually a PhD student when his paper came out. But that sort of put harmonic coordinates in my mind. And it was kind of the safety net that if there was a problem with harmonics, then there was this in principle way to solve it. And then the second key ingredient, so it turned out that one of the big problems is not just the formulation, but the constraint equations, the Einstein constraint equations, that the way you typically evolve things, you solve the constraints at the initial time. At the analytic pencil and paper level, if you could solve it exactly, they'd be propagated with time. But numerically, small truncation errors will see constraint violations. They're going to remain at the truncation error level. But the problem is most formulations, it's like the Einstein equation or the Einstein solution is sitting on the top of a mountain ridge. It's sort of on the unstable part of solution space, hand wavy. So in that case, the small perturbations push the solution away from the desired solution. And so the key to that, to fixing that problem, was so-called constraint damping. Mm. And this was a suggestion of Carsten Bunlech and collaborators, where they proposed, that idea was around for a while. Many people had thought,
Had you met Carsten Bunlech? How did you learn about this? From reading papers or meeting people? Because often meeting people is very important.
Useful information.
That's interesting too. So the David Garfinkel was a paper. I eventually did meet him, but Carsten Bunlech, right, this was November 2004. He visited Caltech. Mm-hmm. And he told me, he's got this constraint damping that works very well with Z4. Well, they proved it for perturbations in Minkowski space. Yeah. And he said, Z4 is very similar to harmonic, so why don't I try it? Literally that weekend, I tried it. It was so simple to add.
And it worked.
Yeah, for single black holes. At the time, I actually didn't have a binary code. I could do single mm-hmm. black holes, but it was it was magic. It was night and day with or without constraint damping. Mm-hmm. Because the community was struggling so much with a binary black hole problem, I actually didn't devote all my time to it. I was thinking, this is something that I'll think about sort of on the side. But as soon as that, it was Thanksgiving 2004, You know, after that weekend, it's like, okay, 100%, let's switch to the binary problem.
I see.
Yeah, that was just that in-person conversation. Uh-huh.
So if I understand you correctly, it was not some insight from computational side, but more really from the relativist side.
Right.
And that you were able to improve the numerical frontier.
Yeah, both of those things, it's sort of, you want, with numerics, so we often call it simulating, but it's not simulation. It's really solving
Einstein's
discrete
equation.
Versions of Einstein equations. Right. So that the underlying, the base for a successful framework is mathematics, right? So the harmonic formulation, mm-hmm. the constraint damping, keeping this under control. And actually, sort of at the time, one of the long laundry list of possible issues that might be problematic. There were thoughts that there were numerical problems. And one problem was lack of resolution. So from the beginning, I made sure that I'd use this adaptive mesh refinement. So that was sort of an important numerical method that I used. But it was a kind of a known method to make sure that I always had enough resolution that I wouldn't run into resolution problems. And that Matthew Choptowick sort of pioneered adaptive mesh refinement. So it had been developed before in other fields, but he brought that into numerical mm-hmm. methods. And say another numerical method that was important was a so-called excision method. And this was suggested by Bill Unruh, actually also at UBC. He was actually Matt Choptik's advisor. So my grandfather. And so the problem with singularities, naked singularities are terrible for prediction, but closed singularities are okay. The ones that occur inside of black holes, in principle, they're okay, because they're causally disconnected from the exterior. But if you're solving, the Einstein equations over space-time, how do you deal with those singularities? And Bill Unruh sort of pointed out, in some sense, in hindsight, it's obvious, but it took someone like that to point it out, that you can just cut out a piece of the domain inside the black hole, mm-hmm. and causality should protect you. If there are no exterior singularities, causality should protect you. And then that in practice became this excision technique. So they were important numerical things, but only now we can look back and see which were the things that did work, which didn't work, and which were the final two things. So by that time, the numerical stuff actually turned out to be okay, and it was these two.
That's why many people after your breakthrough could realize also successful simulations.
Well, actually, I remember your paper came out in July, I think, of 2005.
Yeah.
So I was in Aspen in a conference in June that year. So your paper was not out, but I think you had presented some results.
Yeah, in April at a conference.
Yeah, and I remember the numerical relativist in the at the workshop with this laundry list, I have this in my code, Frans has not this, I have this, just to compare and understand, what to do in order to, that is where actually I learned about the discovery, because I was in at CNRS at that point, but I visited Aspen for that workshop.
Yeah, so maybe I can, because I think after this breakthrough, there was still a kind of maturation required in both the numerical side, but also then you and Frans, you collaborated, right, in sort of joining this analytical
approach. Numerical.
Yeah, that was also...
maybe you can talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, I think I was quite lucky because, September, I moved to the University of Maryland to take over a faculty position there.
So September 2005.
2005, September 2005, and I met people at NASA Goddard. There is a group still now, but at the time very active in numerical relativity, John Baker, John Centrella, and they invited me for a conference in November on numerical relativity, and asked me to talk about the paper that we had finished with Thibault and Yanbei Chen on the first extension of the EOB to spinning black holes, including also the merger in Dow. So at that conference, two groups, not knowing the results of each other, two other groups, presented their merger waveforms, confirming Frans' results.
Numerical groups.
The one at Goddard and the one at the time by Manuela Campanelli and Carlos Lusto. They were in Texas at the time. And so at that conference, I met actually Frans and also Greg Cook. We started talking and we started this collaboration trying. We were very eager to understand the simulation on one side using more analytical tools, but also to compare to the effective one
present,
body.
Did you present at this conference?
Yes, I presented
the
result.
Was to compare in detail numerical results.
Yeah, yeah. So we wanted actually to compare to understand whether there was agreement, whether, you know, this idea of how to model the latent spiral merger in down was really working. And and it was, in fact, quite amazing to see that the model was working quite well, the effective one-body, you know, prediction. Of course, with differences, because it's a semi-analytical, you know, model.
And some of the differences were clearly numerical also, like in the latent spiral, there are wiggles in the thing
well,
of
in
France,
the
which
early
are not...
In the early spiral, there are also modulation due to eccentricity, due to
There were errors on both sides, but there was something clearly in common that they were capturing the same physics.
But okay, maybe let me ask you a slightly provocative question.
Yes.
No, that, I mean, is it now understood, I mean, considering that this is a highly nonlinear and a highly dynamical problem, why does... how does it go? Why were you able to go so far? I mean, of course, nature has been kind, that is good. But now this is going to be the template for, as I understand, for all the future, the way these methods are going to be used now for interpreting gravitational waves in future, right?
Of course, we can always also improve. But I think there are perhaps two parts. One is the in-spiral part of the effective one body approach, the resummation, which actually, even without any information from numerical relativity, one can show that there is an improvement with respect to just plain post-Newtonian.
Although there was a paper by Saul Teukolsky and others saying that there was no improvement at all. So
now I don't know about this.
It's resummed and they said no, it does not improve.
But that was Depardieu actually.
Yes. No, but just to say it's never clear. I mean,
after the
fact, you can say...
Because you compare
the
then with numerical relativity. You compare many quantities. The waveform, you compare periastron advance, you compare the binding energy. So not just, you know, the waveform, but other quantity in the dynamics you can compare. But so I think the resummation of the in-spiral, it's, I would say, quite effective. And
especially
also
the new resummation developed with Balla-Ayer.
That's also important. But I want to say also the merging down description. I think certainly the simplicity, this idea that the signal of the merger is very short in time, and is you know, you have an adiabatic in spiral that continues basically up to merger, and then the quasi-normal mode that are excited quite immediately when the black hole forms, that seems to be there in the numerical relativity simulation. That was also the results of our comparison. The overtones of the quasi-normal mode play a role in that transition. We don't know even today whether this is more physical or phenomenological, but certainly the overtones also help in, you know, having a very smooth transition to the perturbative part of the ring down.
But it's true that we don't have a full understanding why this complicated merger of two black holes is that simple. I mean, we cannot give
it's for
a one-line proof, even a posteriori, why it is so.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of astonishing for somebody from outside the field that... I mean, of course, this is a very interesting question I want to ask you now, because to me, at least, it sort of emphasizes the role of the community. You know, I mean, we are, of course, single out, you know, Dirac medalist or the Nobel laureate as the, you know, but if you really look at it, and you must have experienced it while you were in it, that it's a very complicated story. The future is very unclear. you know, whether you would actually see this in your lifetime is not clear, right? Maybe it could have taken another 40 years before this was discovered. And yeah, so can you comment upon that? That because, you know, there are so many people who have, like you mentioned the name of Vishveshwara, you know, who were doing it for their own reasons. There are also people like Wheeler, you know, who sort of inspired a community to say that, okay, this problem is important. Even when major astronomers were saying that, okay, black hole doesn't even exist, what are you talking about, why are you bothering? Or Einstein himself wrote this wrong paper in 1936 saying that gravitation...
Not wrong, because he was asking the question.
Of maybe non-linearity, non-linear solution. So, you know, there were all these doubts and skepticism in the community, and at the same time, there was a belief that these are important equations. Yeah, so can you comment on this? I think it's a very fascinating question.
Community, and again, speaking of in-person, learning things in person, when I arrived again as a postdoc in 1974, the group around John Wheeler and Remo Ruffini had, and Zerilli, they had worked out already the simpler problem of a small black hole falling into a big black hole. And there they had proven that the quasi-normal modes are created immediately. And I had learned from this firsthand, you know, from them saying the reason is this, and you can. So there was this part of the problem, which was not for two comparable black holes. So the effective one body, in a sense, assumed that what was true for a small one. But it was important to learn from this wisdom around the group in Princeton, which was many years. I mean, Vishveshwara did his work in Princeton also at the time. So
actually, I think he, not in Princeton, I think in Maryland. He was a student of Charlie Misner, so I know about that. He was a student of Charlie Misner.
Misner was a student of Wheeler.
Okay, that's true.
Okay. So there was this, indeed, families of thought that people needed to have the vision that this was important for the future. That, like for instance, for many years, you know, it took 50 years to understand that the black hole was a physical object. Because initially it was a mathematical solution.
Yes.
And one of the first papers who really thought that black holes were physical objects is by Tullio Regge and John Wheeler, where they said, let's perturb the black hole by sending some waves. And then they were saying explicitly, you know, it's like something which vibrates before Vishveshwara, that it's... So it is surprising how long the human minds can get used to new things that are given by equations. I mean, Einstein wrote the equation in November 1915, and to get used that it's that gravitational waves are real, that black holes are real, took many years, took many observational discoveries, like the discovery of binary pulsars, pulsars first, black holes in binary X-ray sources. So the community is very important. And for young people entering the field, who is your advisor, what you learn from people, you are on a wave. Sometimes you are lucky, you say you learn the good things at the good moment. Also because Frans was next to a big group of people in Caltech trying to solve the same problem, next door. You did not talk to them.
Well, and maybe, there were little meetings.
Not then when you got the new ideas, and then you solved the problem before them.
Yeah, we definitely spoke. We had,
okay. There were the famous group meetings.
At least from the way that I like to do research, I'm more for a bit of a loner. Actually, thanks to the fact that I had a Tolman Fellowship, I had the freedom to, how can I put this, to give myself enough rope to hang myself. So it was a risk not joining a group, but it was a large group. And I said, like, what can I help with a group that's already so large?
My contribution would be lost.
Yeah. And instead, I could try some of these other ideas. I might fail, it turned out that... But definitely, there was an environment, there was a lot of discussion. And actually, it was also a time, I think it was the second year that I was there, or perhaps the first year, but that's when this new funding source came up.
Did you need finding? Funding so important for you?
But then to get this initiative started at Caltech, so it was funny that Kip Thorgard He had a year of visitors coming to Caltech. So that actually, Karsten was on that program. So Lee Lindblom was there at the time.
And Lee played an important role.
Lee was very important in organizing all of these things. Mm. But you know, for a week, 2-3 weeks at a time, we'd have all these experts on mathematical analysis, the initial value problem, so numerical methods that came through Caltech. So it wasn't just the people there at Caltech. And that was funded by this.
Yeah, that was very important, that you had that opportunity.
So I was in an incredibly rich environment with various ideas coming through the whole time.
And by the way, that was true also in my case. When I was there, you know, there were experimentalists. I could talk with data analysts when I was at Caltech, astrophysicists. So it was really a very rich environment.
That's exactly what I mean, is that if you look at it, I mean, you also said that, you know, you required analytical methods, then numerical methods. There is also work done purely from a mathematical relativist, like Schocke-Bruha you mentioned yesterday, and observation, you know, people like Weber, you know, who are perhaps not, but you know, who had somehow had the courage or had the foolishness to really say that this problem is important and I'm going to work on it. And unless this entire community had somehow continued in this quest, you know, you would not have reached where
you did. In the case of Joe Weber, for instance, also just to mention, because I met him in 75 at a moment where people, or 76, where people did not, I mean, had proven that what he was saying was incorrect, that he had said he had detected. So he was totally ostracized by the community. Yeah. That's why he could talk to a young guy who was totally neutral. And then he told me that the reason why he got interested and understood that you could detect gravitational waves was because he was discussing every day, taking by car, a mathematician, Marcel Ries, who was an expert in Riemannian spaces and with hyperbolic signature. And then he told him about mathematical things, so-called Jacobi deviation. And then he understood, you know, directly from a mathematician. So Joe Weber was a remarkable person. He came from engineering, and he was a naval engineer to start with. He missed the Nobel Prize several times because he invented the maser before everybody else. Mm-hmm. Then, and he had the courage alone to pursue his dream. I mean, one needs people like that, because all the community then went, because some crazy people for years spend all their life doing this.
I was in 96, I was in Caltech actually, and I remember meeting Kip Thorne. And even then, I mean, I worked in string theory, which also again another long-term project, I would say, of human exploration. It could have been that in his lifetime, this was not going to be realized. So you really require a generational commitment, you know. I mean, I'm going to ask you this, right, that as a graduate student, right, you have no... It could have been that the detection would take 25 years beyond your horizon of your academic career, right? And you really...
Even at the time, there was also, Peter, this sort of sinking feeling that people, numerical relativists, buried very, very deeply, that perhaps there was something fundamental about the Einstein equations that would prevent numerical solution. We didn't.
Why?
Just because there was so much failure.
Before the
breakthroughs, you'd go to numerical relative conferences, and it would be one talk of a failure after another, and describing the failures. Yes. And actually, at the time, now looking back at like how that changed the whole perspective of the community, and again when LIGO discovered, now having real data, that was another sea change. And so we weren't as depressed as we were happy afterwards, but you know, I think to what sort of kept me and a lot of people going, I think, are other kind of other reasons. Like you kind of ignore that possibility of failure, and for me, and that's what I tell all my students is, pick a subject that you love, because you're going to go through dark times. You're going to go through times where you think there might not be a solution. You know, there might be problems that you might not be able to overcome. But if you love the subject, and I love general relativity, you know, gravity as geometry, it's such a fascinating concept. I love computers. So it was something where, despite the problems, I could push my way through. And then I also like I had some of these backup projects that okay, perhaps I wouldn't have gotten me a job in the field, but things like critical phenomena and gravitational collapse or other problems.
Chop-tweak scaling kind of things. Yeah.
And of course, like if you know, if to gravity, as fascinating as it is, if it's you know always like strong field gravity, you know the black holes, like all of these things that I think make you know, make Einstein gravity so fascinating to me. If it didn't have a connection with nature, it would be so disappointing in some sense. It would still be interesting, but it wouldn't be that relevant. And the fact that now there is, and again, you know, like I said, also there, you know, there was. We also have to look. We kind of have to be lucky that the population of black holes in the universe is as large as it is.
No, but I mean, this you could not have foretold. It was not foretold, right? It could have been. I mean, there was no way to. I mean, that's what I want to say that. 100 years had to pass, right, after, it's a kind of a tribute in a way to the remarkable power of our theoretical understanding that, you know, you wrote down some equations.
Yeah, so for example, like Ray Weiss and all the LIGO people, they could have been perfectly correct that they could build this detector with enough sensitivity and the rates were just so low that that wasn't enough.
Yes.
It could have gone that way. Luckily it didn't.
Yeah, because then... they would detect only binary neutron stars because this we know since 1970, which means...
But the rates were not also so clear.
But then it means instead of 100 events, now LIGO would have two events, maybe three, which is a big difference. Nature has been very kind to all
usual.
Of us.
Yes.
As usual.
I think this. Yeah, maybe this is a good point to stop. I think this is really... I mean, this is going to be... It's not just a one-time discovery, in a way it has really opened a whole new window onto the universe. And in some sense, these theoretical calculations is like the retina of the signal, right? That you have to interpret what you're seeing, and the only way you can do it is through this very abstract analysis of complicated differential equations, but they really match onto the what is coming to us from billions of years before, and this is really truly remarkable. If one, I mean, I think in physics we somehow get a bit inert to this, to our field. I mean, we think we take it for granted, a black hole, but if you stop to think about it, it's such a mind-blowing thing that we are sort of, we evolved to pick berries and throw stones, and we are able to we're able to see the black hole coming, you know. So it's it has been a pleasure talking to all of you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.